You already know that I'm an engineer and I'm really passionate about holography. So I believe this will be the technology of the future. I would love to a little bit more about it. When people hear what I do, they usually ask me about Tupac's hologram. And I'm really sorry to tell you that this is just an optical illusion, which has nothing to do with true holography. The way it works is that you have a thin sheet of glass that both transmits and reflects the light. So when you look into it, you see the people standing behind it, as well as the reflection of the Tupac. So I mostly know holography from reading research papers, PhD dissertations, and in fact, I wanted to know a bit more about it. So I made a Google search, the most popular thing, I guess. And I was shocked when I realized that a lot of people who claim that they developed a novel holographic technology were not doing holography in the scientific sense. Of course, these technologies exist and they are quite impressive. But for instance, a 3D display is just a 2D image projected onto a cylindrical surface. As you walk around, you have the impression that you're seeing a person from different perspectives, but it's nonetheless a 2D image. So what is holography? I like to think about holography as playing with light. And you probably heard somewhere that light is a wave. What does it mean for us? I like to imagine this situation as looking at the water waves. As you make a ripple, it travels outwards in a circular manner. Now, if you make two ripples at the same time, you can see that these two waves overlap and form a certain pattern. Now, you will soon realize that there will be some places where our water doesn't seem to move at all. And in some places, we have a large oscillation. Now, a few words for clarification. Water waves are quite big and easy to see. However, light is a very small wave. It's as small as 1/100th of a human hair. And it oscillates very, very fast, as fast as 500 billion times. What does this have to do with holography? So imagine that you have an array, 1,000 by 1,000 small slits, and you can open and close them in any way you want. Now, what you can see on the screen is a sample hologram, which is just an array of black and white squares. Black means a closed slit, and white, an open one. So now each open slit will create a new small wave. And since there's loads of these waves, they will overlap in some way and form a pattern on the screen. What we are doing here is we're telling light that it should appear at certain places, but not the others. Now I should say a few words about hologram generation. As you can guess, it's pretty a complex operation. And in fact, about 10 years ago, you needed a supercomputer to do that calculation within a reasonable time frame. Now you probably don't realize, but most of you have a supercomputer in your own house, and it's called a graphics card. Graphics cards can do operations a lot faster than processors, and do them all in parallel. Now, we said something about holograms, how we generate them. Now, I'm going to tell you how we display them. First of all, you need a source of light, which is a laser. That laser beam illuminates the microdisplay, and later on, we project the image onto the surface. Now, the angle of view depends on the type lens you use. And in fact, in my research, we use a simple ball of glass that gives us a very wide angle, but produces a lot of blur in the image. What is blur? This is the ideal image, And I'm going to show you two types of blur. One of them is called defocus. For instance, it happens when this lens is slightly misplaced from its position. And the other type of blur is called comma. And the name comes from the fact that the point seems to have a tail like a comet. But as I already say, in holography, we design the wave. We tell light how it should behave, and in fact, we can correct that. In order to do that, we use special functions called Zernike polynomials. And to correct the defocus aberration, we use third Zernike polynomial, which looks like that. And in fact, every single aberration has a associated with it Zernike polynomial that corrects it. So we need to know in what proportions to combine the aberrations. And the way I approach the problem is I use the webcam in order to measure the aberrations. And let's have a look at the results. What you should see here is a grid of points. And as you can see, this is quite bad. In the corrected image, in fact, most of the points are small and circular. Next one is the page of text. And if you try to read this, you'll probably have a hard time. And in the corrected version, most of text can be read. So now let's proceed to 3D holography and wonder what makes us see things. So imagine you see the tiger. You see it because the sun illuminated it, and the scattered rays somehow ended up in your eyes. Now imagine that we are somehow able to reproduce the same set of rays that the real object would produce. And in that case, you would see a three-dimensional tiger behind the display. Now, when I was younger, I was interested in computer graphics and programming, and this other definition is slightly closer to my heart. So what you should see here is you take every single point in the image and you focus it at different distance. And that's precisely how you create a 3D hologram. How does it look like? At this point, I was focusing the camera at different depths. And you can see how different parts of the image go in and out of focus. Now I have another... Whoops, sorry. So what you should see here is we have different letters at different distances. It should say TEDx Warsaw. This is the experimental setup using which we view the hologram. We need a source of light, which is a laser diode, two lenses that expand the beam, and as you look into the microdisplay, you see a three-dimensional object. Okay, I'm afraid the video didn't really work, but... what you can see here is we were moving our viewpoint. And in fact, this situation is somehow similar to approaching platform on the train. The platform itself moves very, very fast. The trees, some distance away, move by the small amount. And the sun and the sky doesn't seem to move at all. And that is precisely what is happening here. So you've seen some basic properties of 3D holograms. However, these holograms were pretty simple. And at this point, I'm going to show you what a lot of resources and computer power can do. And this system can display a 3D image that is 14 centimeters in size and do that in real time, means 30 times a second. However, it requires this system is pretty expensive and requires a lot of computers in order to produce the image. However, researchers all over the world are working in order to shrink the system, improve the image quality, and make it available for everyone.